Thank you for making the time to join this webinar. I'm Laurens Kok. I'm the head of foreign investments at the DIEK Business Agency, and I'm here together with David Korsak from Lagro Geelkerken Lawyers and Gerk Officier, a policy advisor from the DIEK International Center. So as the COVID-19 crisis spreads across Europe and the US, companies are scrambling to navigate through this crisis and these difficult times. There are no easy answers to the unpredictable dynamics of this disease and the lack of experience to deal with these kinds of things. So clearly, every situation is different, but we'll try to give you some answers to your most pressing questions with regards to today's topic, successful strategies to overcome the COVID-19 crisis. The employer and employee must known rules currently. So looking at the program, if I might have the next slide. So after some more information about the webinar, I'll start with the main update on the economic measures, after which David will continue with a talk about the wage compensation scheme, and as well as the problems that occur for foreign companies in this scheme. After which Gerco will talk about immigration travel restrictions for international companies. And in the last half an hour, there's room for a Q&A. So during the session, you can submit your questions through the Q&A box below. We reserved about half an hour to answer them. Questions which are still left by then, we will try to answer afterwards by email. And we will record this webinar, and the recording will be sent to you by email afterwards, as well as some notes and a recommended list of information and resources about the schemes. And of course, you're very welcome to reach out to one of us or our organizations afterwards if any more support is needed. Also, we would like to have your feedback on the quality of this webinar, and but the instructions for that will follow later. So, as we are almost 7 weeks down already in the Netherlands, the crisis has massive impact on our daily lives as well as on the economy. By definition, a crisis requires constant reframing of our mental models, planning and response, recovery strategies, and also looking into post-recovery strategies already, and hopefully finally some reflection and learning, but that's all for later. So, but the process must be fast, so our organizations can adjust to changing circumstances, and that's where we're in right now. So while China appears to be in the early stage of recovery, Europe is another thing. I guess some countries are opening up again, Austria, but most parts of Europe are still in the early days. So that's why governments put all kinds of benefits and measurements in place. Also, the Dutch government did, and so I now quickly want to walk you through the different schemes that are in place. So first, there's the wage compensation scheme via what it's called the NOW bridging measure. The most important one, David will go into that later. Almost 1 billion euros is already granted within this scheme. So I guess people find their ways. There's the one-set compensation of 4,000 euros via reimbursement for companies in most affected sectors. And what we've seen is that more and more sectors are allowed to make use of this measure recently. There's the government loan guarantees, which are in place before the crisis as well, but the boundaries are widened, so it's up to 150 million euros loan guarantees, and the guarantee is about 50% by the government. There is the tax deferral scheme to be applied with the tax authority on income tax as well as corporation tax, payroll tax, and VAT. And today, the special measurement for start and scale-ups opened, put in place by TechLeap and the regional development agencies, together with InvestNL, the new vehicle for commercial investments by the Dutch government. It's a scheme from 50k to 2 million loan on a 3% interest rate. And if the loan is applied for a large amount of 250k, 25% of co-financing is necessary. But locally, in by the city of The Hague, there are also schemes in place. Most of them focused on self-employed. So there's the income and business support for self-employed, working capital loan for self-employed people, and also a deferral on a local tax payment on a property tax, TURIC tax, and even parking permits for entrepreneurs. So that's more or less the oversight of the current benefits measurement in place. And now I want to move forward to some more advice from experts in this field and frequently asked questions in that regard. So I will hand over to Gerco then. As introduced, Gerco is part of the International Center, the expat desk of the City of The Hague, knows everything about staff mobility. Yeah. Gerco, you will discuss how to deal with your non-EU employees in particular. Gerco, I'll give you the floor.
Okay, thank you, Lawrence. Good morning, everyone. I will explain a little bit today about global mobility issues regarding the coronavirus now and the measurements. First of all, works a policy advisor for the Hague International Center. And the International Center is the contact point for all international staff in the Hague region. We're part of the City of The Hague, and we help with formalities, but also with like English information about living and working here. So we organize events, we contact people, connect people to service providers, and we help employers with hiring international staff. And today we'll say a little bit about travel restrictions, about immigration restrictions, and about the effect on international staff you might have in your company. First of all, global mobility at this point is very difficult, mostly because the EU, UK, and Schengen borders are closed until the 15th of May for non-European employees. However, they're not entirely closed. They're closed for business travel, tourism, and stuff. But for urgent matters, you can still travel to the European Union. And urgent matters, for example, are urgent family crises, like a family member is dying or severely ill. People working in vital sectors or processes are still allowed to come into the country. Diplomats and people who already have a residence permit. So if you're approved to work here, you can still travel to the country if you can find a flight, because part of the travel restrictions is that most airline companies grounded their flights. It's very difficult to get into the EU at this moment. We advise people to come directly to the Netherlands if you want to travel here. For example, because Germany and Belgium close their borders partly to the Netherlands as well, you need to have a really good reason to travel in between European countries as well. So it might change, it might create a little bit of hassle if you travel to a different country. New regulation is that from the 17th of April, everyone needs to fill in a health certificate. You get one from the airline company, but it's a new measure, not really well known yet. It's basically sort of a fit to fly document where you state that you don't have any medical issues. If you do have medical issues, you may not be allowed to board the airplane. All travelers coming to the Netherlands are advised to self-quarantine for 14 days at this moment, and they are informed by the Dutch government about all the measures with flyers and leaflets. So partly the problem with global mobility at this moment is travel restrictions. Another word is the immigration processes. Because the Dutch embassies and consulates abroad are all closed until further notice, they only open if you have an urgent need to travel to the Netherlands. This is mostly if you work in a vital sector. Think about life science and health. You're working on vaccines, working in healthcare, or for example, you work in energy production. So the things for you which you definitely need to travel, you can still get a provisional residence permit, like an MVV, to travel into the country. But otherwise, they're closed. The IND desk, so the Immigration and Naturalization Service, is also mostly closed. It suspended all its operations at all the expat centers throughout the country, and their own desks are only closed for urgent matters. And the only urgent matter they consider right now is if you have to pick up your first residence permit after you traveled into the country, and on the condition that you have an MVV, so that you have a provisional residence permit from an embassy. And basically, you have to provide your biometrical information at an embassy abroad. Otherwise, they cannot issue a residence permit.
Jij bent weer terug. Ja, je had hem niet op internet aangesloten.
Oh ja, hoe kon ik daar net horen dan?
David, can you mute your...
Wifi gaat.
Conversation. Basically, the Dutch authorities are very flexible when you don't have your residence permit. Usually you get an in-confirmation letter from the IND mentioning that you are approved to work here. This letter is also a confirmation that you are allowed to work here. A problem which is now happening is that some people have to overstay their short stay visa as a business traveler or tourist, or also their residence permit because they cannot travel back to their country of origin. In this case, please notify the IND about any changes, but the government is quite lenient because they know, because of travel restrictions, you are not allowed to travel back to your country. So if you report it to them, usually they're quite flexible and there won't be any fines like there used to be. Third topic I would like to discuss is the effect of international employees. First, we're seeing that a lot of international staff listens to the news in their home country. As an employer, please provide them information about the Dutch measurements. Basically, because they might differ between China, between Italy, between Spain and the Netherlands. And it's a little bit, sometimes it's a loss of travel movement that people listen to follow the measurements in their own country, and in the Netherlands they might be different. Please also inform them about support measures. Dutch municipalities are usually the one who have a lot of support measures for vulnerable groups. So think about people are ill now, they're not allowed to go to the supermarket. The Dutch government has schemes in place to help employees to receive all kinds of help in terms of groceries, support, taking care of sick people. But these are usually not the measures which are known to the international staff here. So please provide them a list of where they can get help. They can also reach out to the international center and we can help them in their way. We see a lot of new employees which are hired to come to the Netherlands. They cannot start working here, but they can do so from abroad. In this temporary time, you can also request a BSN, a citizen service number, which you need to be on the payroll and therefore to be able to receive some salary. You still need to ask the government for that. You can do so via the tax office. In this emergency times, they send BSN numbers to the service providers or to the employee itself. Be wary that the start of working from abroad does have effect on your residence permit, maybe in this country. Not everyone is allowed to work in the country they're residing now. Also, it has effect on taxation and social security, because you're not taxed in Netherlands, but you're taxed in the country you start working. David will tell a little bit more about the emergency support measures for government and for employers. Be wary that some of your international staff has a specific residence permit with conditions, and it's usually in these residence permits you're not allowed to ask for government support. You are allowed to ask help for benefit schemes for which you pay premiums, for example, unemployment benefits. But for example, highly skilled migrants, they have a salary criterion. Please be wary that if your employees fall below the salary criterion because, for example, they cannot work, do report this to the IND. We're not quite sure what the effect will be. They may be lenient, but so far we haven't seen any communication officially. So please take into account the salary thresholds that you still need to uphold them as an employer. International entrepreneurs can apply to the bridging measures done by the municipality. Usually international entrepreneurs are also not allowed to ask for government funds, but in this case, the ministry made an exemption. Last thing to say is sometimes international staff has a residence permit depending on a family member, for example, a Dutch person working here and their sponsor had a residence permit, or another family member who has a highly skilled permit and you basically hire the spouse, for example. Be wary that their residence permit is dependent, and if the salary conditions are changing at the sponsor, that might have an effect on the family member or partner as well. So try to look into which international staff you have in payroll and whether this has an effect on them. This was my brief talk. Maybe there's some questions to discuss at a later stage. And if you have further questions, always reach out to the International Center and can see how we can help your staff with visas, residence permit, travel restrictions, and basically general life and work life in The Hague. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Gerco. Very interesting. So please submit your questions to Gerco in the Q&A box, and we will be able to answer them later on. So moving over to Geelkerke lawyers, David Korsak. David, the floor is yours.
What I'll be talking about today related to the current COVID-19 crisis, the so-called temporary emergency bridging measure for sustained employment, but it's most of all known to us as the NOW application for government benefits in order to help struggling entrepreneurs to bridge over this difficult period of time. I think most of you, or at least a large quantity of you who've joined this webinar, have probably already applied for it. What I'll do mostly today is tell you about my experience so far for all the applications I've made on behalf of my clients, answer a few questions maybe you have about this issue. But for those of you who have not applied for it yet, or perhaps have not heard about the NOW application yet, I'll give a short introduction about this, and then I'll come back again to my own experiences on this matter. So to start out again, so what is the NOW? The NOW basically is that the Dutch government used to have a scheme called the work time reduction. Basically it is, if you are experiencing difficult economic times and the cause of it is temporary, then you could apply for the reduction of the work time of your employees. This scheme was not sufficient, according to the Dutch state, for the current corona crisis, which most of us would agree with. So they set up a new measure called the NOW. For the NOW, you don't reduce the work time of your employees. They still work full time, but the Dutch government will cover a large amount of your employees' salary. How's the formula done? I think a lot of you have heard about this. Basically, it is what the Dutch government will do is they take the turnover of 2019, divide by four, so you have a quarter. And what they'll then do is they pick 3 months. Normally, that will be March, April, and May. And they will compare that to each other, and then should there be a reduction of at least 20% in turnover, then you're eligible for the NOW, and the Dutch government will pay you 90% of the actual decrease percentage-wise in turnover. So, for example, if your turnover has been reduced to zero, meaning a decrease of 100% in your turnover, then the Dutch government will compensate you 90% of all your employees. If your turnover is, let's say, 50%, then the Dutch government will cover, 45% of your employee's salary. Quite simple, right? Now, quite a few of you have probably already applied for it. Keep in mind, though, for those of you who did not apply for it, you have until the end of May, so the 31st of May, to apply for it. That's the deadline. And it is applied retroactively, so you can choose starting dates to be the 1st of March, even if you would apply it, for example, somewhere in May. They will pay it to you retroactively. Now, how does this work in practice, however? Now, on the 6th of April, the applications opened. And as some of you have seen, whether or not you're an HR manager or you're your own employer and you've applied it for it yourself, you've seen actually that it's quite simple, this application. It's very straightforward, almost no additional documents or evidence required. Basically, what you need to apply for is give them a copy of your bank account statement so they can be sure that it's actually your bank account and that you're not committing fraud. And that's basically it. And sign a statement whereby you agree that everything you've submitted is correct. The reason why it's so simple, and I'll come back to that later, is because that's not the definite application yet. This is just the first initial application. The actual application, whereby you need to submit much more information probably, will come later. We'll come back to that later. Let's start first of all with what the actual formula is that the Dutch government uses to pay or compensate the employers who applied for the NOW. Now, as I mentioned before, the simple version is, of course, 90% of the actual decrease in turnover. But as you see probably now on the screen, it's a little bit more complicated than that. And you can see three more factors being being considered. I'll start with the first one. What they'll first do is that they'll take the full amount of the wage sum of January 2020, so this year. What the wage sum is, in Dutch it's called loonsom, is basically the entire sum of all your employees' salaries combined together. That's the wage sum. This also includes the government insurance tax, Social Security insurance tax. So it's not just the gross salary, it also includes the Social Security tax, but it's also included in this formula already. As you see, the 1.3 takes in consideration the Social Security tax. That's the 1.3 factor. And then times three, meaning of course, the 3 months whereby it's applied for. So that is the actual formula. So as you see, I've actually answered a few questions before of people asking me, am I, for example, allowed during this period whereby I applied for the NOW, is whether or not I can terminate the employment agreement of my employees. The answer to that is, depends. If it is for company economic reasons, so mostly a reorganization, then the answer is no, you're not allowed to do that. If you would do that, you're actually going to probably receive a penalty for it, and the government is going to request the money back again. Okay. Am I allowed to, for example, not extend an agreement that would end, for example, at the end of this month? Yeah, you are allowed not to extend it. There's no obligation to keep continuing or extend that agreement. Or am I allowed to terminate an agreement of an employee that I'm unhappy with, so that he doesn't perform well? Answer to these questions is yes, you're allowed to, but as mentioned before, the baseline for this calculation is the wage sum of January 2020. At the end of it, when the Dutch government will check whether or not what the actual wage sum is, so they'll check the wage sum of March, April, and May, they will see if you terminate an agreement, they will see there's actually a reduction in the wage sum. So then there's probably going to request that money back again. So keep that in mind. I see I have 3 minutes left, so I'll pick a few of the more important aspects. First of all, so again, this is not the final application that you made. The definite application will be made after this period. So within 24 weeks from the top of my head, the actual application has to be made and will probably, most likely, also require the statements of your registered accountant. So they cannot just judge it on the basis of your own turnover, right? Okay, now, the UWV, which actually pays out and whereby the application has to be made, will have 52 weeks to confirm this application and consider whether or not it's correct or not, and consider whether or not the final sum that they offered you is correct. Yeah? If they paid you too much, I assure you they will ask back again. If they pay you too little, then they will give you some more. Yeah, because they actually hold, they when they pay out, they don't pay out the full amount of the compensation. They first pay out 80% of that amount. So 20% they'll keep there and they can discount it with each other and see whether or not they need to pay you more or less on the basis of that. Keep in mind that you need to keep all documentations for at least 5 years. In case the Dutch tax authorities will do an audit on you. Yeah. In my experience so far, and then I'll finalize this presentation, the process is actually quite smooth, which is, I think, for most of you are aware with working with the Dutch government, especially tax authorities or UWV, is extraordinary. Most of my clients, whereby I made the application, have received the NOW compensation within 5 days so far. It's very fast. Which is logical because the information you provide is not a lot. Their idea is pay first, we'll figure out later after this period whether or not the application you made and the money we paid you is correct or not. Yeah. So I think those are the basic aspects of it. If you did not apply for it yet and you are eligible for it, I would recommend you to apply for it. The process so far is very smooth, painless, but be aware, should you have received too much compensation, then you really need to make sure that you keep that amount at the bank account. Actually, it's only allowed to use to compensate your employees' wages. And should they have paid you too much, at least you have the amount on that bank account where they pay you on, and you can pay back the Dutch government again. Yeah. And I'll come back again to the questions. But this is basically a quick overview of how the NOW works and what my experience is with it so far. Thank you very much.
Thank you, David. Interesting to know your experience with this scheme. We've done a lot of talking already. And now we'd like to hear from you. I see some questions coming in. We try to answer them all. Q&A box is open for questions, and I'll start with two questions for Gerco. One submitted by Leon Blok. Thanks, Leon. He stated there, new experts are allowed to come in, as he understands. Gerco, is there a date foreseen that these measures will end, the travel restrictions?
The travel restrictions are now until the 15th of May. The European Union is working to harmonize the opening up of the border, because before all countries separately started closing borders to each other. For now it's 15th of May, but last time the European Commission already advised all countries to extend it. So we have to look into what's going to happen on that side. More importantly is when do the airline companies start going at regular schedules? Because a lot of the airline companies are not flying anymore to major destinations. So I think that's more important as well. And all measurements in the Netherlands are extended until the 19th of May. We don't know for sure if then the embassies, consulates, and the IND will be fully operational again, because basically those are the main factor on preventing people from traveling here. So we have to see what happens. One caution is we already hear some companies, they all want to travel immediately the day after, Of course, government services have to start up again, taking into account new measures. So not all government services will be fully operational immediately. So it might take a little bit more time to approve your applications. So be wary that there will be still some setback in the coming months.
Thanks, Gerco. I hope this answers your question, Leon. Question came in about the zoekjaar for graduated students. So this stagnated according to Yin van Yang. Thanks for the question, Yin van. So will they be granted an extension, Gerco? Is there any information on the zoekjaar scheme?
So far, we don't know yet. Of course, we understand that there's a problem. The zoekjaar orientation year permit is a one-year permit for everyone else listening, where students who graduated from a top-tier university or a Dutch university have 1 year to find a job in the Netherlands. However, a lot of employers now are not hiring anymore because they want to understand first what is the impact on the business. For now, we have no reason to believe that the zoekjaar is automatically extended because basically it was the year and now it's only been 1 month of measures. But I will ask the information at the IND, so the Immigration Service as well, whether they are more lenient now towards extending, because usually the zoekjaar is non-extendable. You can only stay in the country if you find a job. But I'll get back to you after asking the IND for a definite comment.
Thanks, Gerco. I hope this helps, Ying Fan. So moving over to some questions for David. The first one is about NGOs, non-profits, and obviously not companies, maybe not making profit turnover they do. But have you seen cases where they were granted the wage compensation in the NOW bridging measure?
Yeah, exactly. I think what you need to keep in mind is a few things, though. So the companies that are eligible, just a few requirements for you to be able to apply for the NOW. First of all, it has to be a 20% reduction in turnover. That is interesting because for NGOs, it's maybe difficult to show whether or not what actually their turnover is. They don't have a turnover. After all, they're an NGO. What they do though is if they have employees, they do pay social security income tax over that. So in that sense, that might make them eligible. But the problem is going to be whether or not they have turnover. And what I think might be an issue, but again, I have not applied it for NGOs yet. So maybe this is a question that I have to come back to later if I do my research. But I think what the issue might be is that NGOs, it's debatable whether or not, because again, the Dutch government is not too strict when they say, normally speaking, if you have to apply for the NOW, you have to show that you're actually affected by the COVID-19. Normally speaking, if you show that you have a decrease in turnover, then the Dutch government says, well, must be caused by COVID-19. However, if they have reason to assume that your organization or enterprise is not actually affected by COVID-19, then it's debatable not whether or not you're eligible for it. And with NGOs, I have my doubts, but of course, I'll do my due diligence on this after this webinar, is that it's debatable whether or not COVID-19 has affected their turnover, actually, because they don't have a turnover. So my first initial reaction would be, I think they might not be eligible for this. But again, I'll come back to this question later on and see if I can offer you a more definite answer to that. Yeah, but it's an interesting question, absolutely. Yeah, thanks for that question.
Okay, thanks, David. And then so we will follow up on this one. Then there's a technical question coming in from Teresa. David, I don't know if you can also read along about the maximum daily wage in the VTR. Will this be applied on all the premiums and bonus and lease cars as well?
That's an interesting question. Exactly. Now, keep in mind the following: the UWV will apply the maximum daily wage, which is set at. Your monthly wage cannot pass 9,530 euros. I say from the top of my head. So let's say you have an employee who makes. I'm just saying something. If you work for a bank, for example, and he makes a salary of, let's say, 10,000 euros, then for the purposes of the NOW application, they will only consider your salary up to the amount of 9,530 euros. With regards to your bonuses and everything else, bonuses will also include basically everything that's considered income that will be included in it, but it's already calculated in the so-called formula that I showed you first on. It's calculated in the 1.3 factor already. So to summarize, 9,530 euros is the maximum salary that they're going to consider on a monthly basis. And the things like vacation pay and other things, they're already calculated within the 1.3 factor in the NOW payout formula. If I can maybe just jump in, going a little bit off script there, because it's something interesting that Gerco pointed out, is with regards to highly skilled migrants and how that works out, whether or not they're eligible still for their residence permit, and how that works in tandem, in combination with the NOW application. Now, as Gerco rightfully mentioned, in order to be eligible for as a highly skilled migrant to receive your residence permit, one of the main requirements is, of course, that you fulfill the minimum wage requirements set as a highly skilled migrant. From the top of my head, somewhere if you are 30 plus, it's 4,000 plus. I think nowadays 4,500. Not an immigration expert. And if you are below 30, I'm saying it's very simple, then it's somewhere 3,000 plus euros. I would like to say to those companies who hire highly skilled migrants is they don't need to worry about whether or not the employees are still eligible for the residence permit in the Netherlands anymore if you apply for the NOW. The reason for that is that the NOW will not affect your salary, because what happens is that the employees will still receive the same wage from their employer. What the NOW does is that they compensate the employer, but they do not pay it that compensation to the employees directly. So the employer still continues to pay the same wage to the employees. So it will not affect their KM status in the Netherlands, their highly skilled migrancy status. This was different before with the work time reduction, because what the work time reduction actually did was reduce the salary that the employer had to pay to his employees. And then the Dutch government would compensate that amount to up to a certain amount by paying out their built up unemployment benefits. Now, in that case, somebody with a highly skilled migrancy status would come into trouble, because officially they would not receive the minimum wage anymore. So keep in mind, so for the NOW, no problem at all. But if you as a company want to get creative with battling this COVID-19 situation and consequences thereof, I've known some employers who say, you know what, I'm going to make an agreement with my employees for this period of time, 1 month, you know what, let's all agree, we all need to work together, we all take a reduction in pay of 50%. Well, it sounds noble, it sounds like a good idea, but keep in mind, if your employees are applied for, have a KM status or highly skilled status in the Netherlands, then what actually happens is that it's very likely that their wages does not fulfill the requirements of the IND anymore, of the minimum wage requirement for highly skilled migrants. So then you would come into danger, and your employees might get a letter from the IND saying you are not in compliance anymore with the requirements set by the immigration offices. How the IND will actually deal with it, it depends, because this is all new law. But strictly speaking, if I would apply Dutch law, then you would come into trouble. But again, for the NOW, no problem at all, assuming you still continue to pay your employees the same wages anymore. Yeah, sorry for that tangent, but I thought I'd pick that up as well.
Thanks, David. Of course, important for all international companies. I see some more questions coming in about the search year for graduates. As stated by Gerco, he will try to find out, and then we'll revert later after this webinar via email. So moving over to questions with some other topics, David or Gerco, if employees decide to go back to their country of origin, which we have seen a lot, can the company still apply for the NOW for this employee? And what are the maybe the restrictions in that regard?
Can I give the floor? Pick it up, Gerco?
Yeah.
Sure. Yeah, okay, sure. So if I understand the question correctly, is if the employees now, if they go abroad, but they still work and still get salary, whether or not you're still eligible for the NOW?
Yes, and will that remain forever, or is there maybe a time limit to this?
Oh, sorry, if I did not mention it before, if you apply for the NOW, it is for a period of 3 months, depending on your starting dates. That's also a point which I did not have time to elaborate, but you can choose your starting point. It can start from the 1st of March, but you can also choose to start from the 1st of April or the 1st of May, and then for a duration of 3 months, and possibly, we're not sure what the Dutch government will do yet, there's also the possibility to extend it again for another 3 months. So that's how that works out. But if you ask me what happens if an employee, and he gets permission from his employer, of course, which he needs, because you cannot choose as an employee to do it yourself. If, for example, he would move to, back to China again, but he's still able to work and he still gets the same salary, and over that salary, the employer pays Social Security, I do not see any reason why he would not be included with the NOW compensation, because the wage sum will still remain the same from the perspective of the Dutch tax authorities. Because it's also worth to mention, you don't need to fill out any forms with regards to your employee salary. You don't need to fill out that. So employee 1, 2, or 3 gets this and this much salary. You don't need to do that, because the Dutch tax authorities already have that information. They receive it every month when you pay your social security taxes. So that is a given. So as long as the Dutch tax authorities have seen that this employee has that over salary, the social security tax is paid from, then you're still eligible for the NOW and the employee will be included with it. Doesn't matter where he works.
Thanks, David.
And I think to
Gerco, please.
To add on, important is if your employee travels back to their home country and continues working there, all residence permits have a set limit. You can actually stay outside of the country. For example, with most residence permits, if you stay outside the country for more than 180 days, you might lose your residency status here. So be wary what kind of residence permit you have, how long you can actually stay out of the country, and otherwise, if you think it might harm the residency rights you have, inform the IND. They're quite lenient, but they want to know in advance usually, instead of when you call them when it's too late.
Thanks. Okay, then there's a question of Ying Sun, because she apparently has seen the turnovers of her company arise because of online sales. Obviously, people spend more time buying stuff online these days. But because of the self-isolation and social distancing, of course, the working hours of employees are less. So is there a possibility, David, to still apply for the NOW, do you think? Or do you see any chances there?
I see the question. So again, the requirements for the NOW, and there's multiple ones, but the main requirement still is the same. You need to show to the Dutch government that you have at least reduction in turnover of at least 20%. If during this period you actually have more turnover than last year, so because they compare to an average quarter of 2019, then by the definitions of requirements set by the UWV, you do not fulfill its requirements. You cannot apply for the NOW. If you do have a reduction in turnover of at least 20%, but later on you see, so for example, it was lower in March, but then suddenly you see in April and in May, there's an increase, but you already applied for it. And of course, when you applied for it, for those of you who applied for it, you know it, you already have the turnover numbers, at least internally, for the month of March. But you don't have the turnover numbers, of course, for April and May yet. So what you do is you make a prediction. If for whatever reason that prediction is wrong and your turnover is actually more positive than you expected, then that doesn't matter eventually, or doesn't matter, let's put it this way. Eventually, when you make your definite statement, yeah, which goes along with a statement of an accountant, you provide that to the UWV, and the UWV will say, oh, well, okay, we paid you more than you actually required, apparently, because apparently your turnover was more positive than you expected. So what we'll do is we still have the remaining 20% that we did not pay out yet. Maybe we only pay 10% of that amount, or less, or more, depending. So that basically you have to pay that amount back again eventually. Yeah.
Thanks.
If I answered your question that way, please let me know if I did not answer your question correctly, or if this is not the platform for it right now, feel free to contact me directly and I can further elaborate.
Yeah, that obviously accounts for all three of us. Further questions, we are happy to answer afterwards. Question by Panvi Srivicha, sorry for announcing it maybe a bit odd. The expat employees can register at the company address, Gerco, as you know, for the first 90 days. But during this period, it's kind of hard to search for a resident house and thus an address. So is there a possibility of extending this period of 90 days?
I'm not going to say anything definite right now. This is a measure that the International Center uses itself, that new expats can register here for 2 months on the company address to allow them to find a house. What we see is that most real estate agents are still viewing houses together with their clients. They're still renting and selling houses. And even the market is doing pretty much the same as in March. So we'll have to see on a case-by-case basis what is the reason they cannot find a house for extension. Because even now, a lot of offices are empty. Government letters are still going to arrive at the company address, and we find out that sometimes a problem that the letter arrives and you have to take action within a few days and no one is at the company, so they cannot open the letters. So Paulina, I will get back to you on an individual basis about this specific employee.
Okay, and so quickly, there's an added question to the same topic, Gerco, by Juliette Delacroix. So some employee returned back to the country of origin due to COVID and wants to terminate the lease contract of their apartment. Can she now be registered at the company address? Possible.
Usually we only allow people to register the company address when they arrive in the lands. I think in this case, the question is also about whether you can stop paying for your apartment. This is not really related to your registration. Of course, you can stop using the apartment. The registration is more aligned to that in the Netherlands, the rules are if you stay here for more than 4 months, you have to register in the municipal personal records database. So it's called BRP for your BSN. If you leave the country for more than 8 months, you actually have to officially immigrate in the system. So I'm not sure if that's the case here, if they expect to be back quite soon or not. So I think as well, I will contact you personally, Juliet, to see what's happening in this case and if we can find a solution. Because maybe there's other ways to we can make sure the registration is upheld. The IND is more flexible with the registrations. However, if you deregister in the municipal system, automatically a message is sent to the IND because basically you're saying I immigrated from the country and it might void your residence permit here. So we have to avoid this and we have to see what is possible here. Maybe we have to contact the IND as well to prevent this from happening.
Thanks, Gerco. Moving over to a question by Rutger van den Hoven about the an exception in the travel ban for staff of humanitarian organizations. I haven't heard about it, but Gerco, maybe you got a sense of this exception already, and do you know how this is implemented? Maybe, or do we need to get back to Rutger?
Yeah, Rutger, thanks for the question. The exception made for humanitarian organization, it's true there might be an exception because it's considered a vital sector in this country. However, it really depends on where the employee comes from. For example, if it's an employee who needs usually an MPV, so a provisional residence document from a Dutch consulate abroad, they'll have to contact the consulate to get an emergency MPV. And this is one of the reasons that some consulates are still open for this urgent matters. However, you have to prove some other things as well beyond working in a vital sector. You have to prove that you can actually find a flight, which in some countries is more difficult than getting the visa. And you have to provide information of why your case is urgent. So only saying I have to work in The Hague because my office is there is not going to be a valid reason. Your vital process has to also continue. You have to be sort of essential to it. So for example, is it someone from China, someone from, you know, not Canada, not the US and stuff, and they need a visa, you have to contact the consulate and ask for the visa itself. If you are from a country where you don't need a visa to travel to the Netherlands, I have to get back to you how you prove that you are working for a humanitarian organization. It might be up to the Koninklijke Marechaussee, as we say, the military border police, to decide whether you can actually enter the country. Because according to the travel restrictions right now, they can refuse everyone according to the Schengen Treaty. So it might be that they need some extra documentation about, for example, the humanitarian organization and some staff records to prove that they're actually necessary in the Netherlands. So I'll get back to you to the question on people who don't need a visa to travel in the country, how they can actually prove this.
Thanks, Gerco. I saw another question coming in by Karin Velser-Boer about a new employee who wants to come into the Netherlands by car to start her employment, holding a valid residence and working permit, I guess. But obviously, that's perfectly allowed if you are able to cross the borders, which are restricted in many ways by the different countries. Then if she is able to make it here, then she can start working. Yeah. So to finish off on the traveling, there's still more a technical question for David.
Can I add to the
the
car? We have seen people come in already by car from different countries, if they have a residence permit or EU citizen and a work contract here. The problem is that the Belgian and German authorities are more strict with traveling. In the Netherlands, you can still travel freely around. However, for example, the border between Belgium and the Netherlands, you need permits, and in Germany as well. So it's basically up to the authorities there to arrange that someone's able to travel outside of the country rather than traveling into the Netherlands. So we've definitely seen people, especially from Germany, travel here, but they need an extra permit to be able to leave the country.
Thanks, Gerco. So we have a couple of minutes left, but there is a definite a technical good question by Xuefri Lee. So which I will consider as the last questions that are not answered, we try to answer in writing afterwards. So she stated, David, that on income, the paper of the income of her company is doing well, but clients having problems with payment. So the money, I guess, is not flowing in. So will they be able to apply for the NOW if they can prove this to the authorities. David.
I see. I think this is more of maybe perhaps of an accountancy issue. I'm not too aware how you do that, but okay, let's put it this way. Again, the main requirement for being eligible for the NOW is whether or not you can show that you have a turnover of, let's say a reduction in turnover of at least 20%. The concept or the definition of turnover is, of course, always going to be a point of discussion. As I say, I think, what is it? Profit is an opinion and cash is a fact. So turnover, you know, there's many ways how you can calculate turnover. If you find a way, but this is something maybe we have to ask an accountant, if I can link turnover with the ability of your debtors, whether or not they can pay you or not, if you can link those together, then you can actually show that there's a reduction in turnover. But again, I think that is more of an accountancy issue, and it's something also I need to figure out, because I understand the point. On paper, you're making a profit, but you're not seeing the cash because your debtors cannot pay for it. I think it does affect your turnover eventually. And I think if you get an accountant statement that claims the same, make the distinction between, listen, obviously there's an invoice, but the invoice remains unpaid and will likely remain unpaid for the foreseeable future because of circumstances caused by COVID-19. And again, if this is confirmed by your registered accountant, then I think it's not going to be an issue. Well, I'm a little bit apprehensive of giving you a definite answer, but I think it's possible to solve this. Yeah, I think this is something you need to discuss with your accountant mostly, whether or not it's possible under accountancy rules to link your turnover with whether or not with the ability of your debtors, whether or not they can pay your invoices. That's how I would answer it at the moment. Yeah.
Thanks, David. That finishes off the Q&A section of this webinar. And actually, it's the end of the webinar today. So I would gradually thank all attendees, which were many, for your time today, and thank Gerco and David for the contribution as well. So our next webinar will take place on May 14th. In the same format, 30 minutes presentations and 30 minutes Q&A. The topic will be also on the economic measures, but what legal risks and opportunities do they give? So please stay tuned for the next webinar. And in the meanwhile, obviously, business agency stays open for business. Happy to assist in all your questions, as well as maybe companies that are moving operations. We can always give advice and have a look at our new website in the meanwhile, launched last week, and I hope to see you soon, and thanks again, and enjoy the rest of the day.